Good evening, one and all. Welcome to the Unbundled Series 2020. It's fabulous to see so many of you joining us today. So first and foremost, thank you so much for joining in this initiative. I'll do a quick introduction of what this series is, give an introduction of the objectives of the series, the host organizations, and then we'll take the conversation forward. So the Unbundled series is an initiative of Shiksha Lokam to energize solution-driven conversations for the recommendations in the new National Education Policy 2020. The first of this series is dedicated to an integral aspect of the policy, which is ECCE, Early Childhood Care and Education. And this is in collaboration with one of Bangalore's formidable NGOs, Makkal Jagriti. Just to give an overview of what the series is going to look like. So this is a three-part series, which will look into three key objectives. One, understand the science behind ECCE, its relevance and its importance, which is today's session. Two, explore best practices in ECCE and deep dwell into implications of the recommendations in the National Education Policy 2020. And third, build solutions to address these implementation challenges as a collective. I will also like to introduce the two host organizations of today. Shiksha Lokam is an education leadership platform under the Shivalal Family Philanthropic Initiatives that aims to enable and amplify leadership opportunities in the K-12 education system. Makkal Jagriti, on the other hand, is a Bangalore-based nonprofit that seeks to create holistic learning platform and empower socially economically deprived children and the community as a whole through multiple programs, be it in the space of ECCE, in school education, and community interventions. This session is taking place on Zoom, as most of you are here logged in, but is also live on the official Facebook page of Makkal Jagriti. In case you're not able to log in using Zoom, please do participate via the Facebook page. The details of this is shared in multiple outlets, including the Google invite that has been shared with all of you. We have attendees from all across the country joining us today from different walks of life, which is one of the most exciting factors for us. We have CSOs working in the field. We have CSOs working to explore the aspect of ECCE. We have academicians. We have students and we have fellows from different fellowship programs. With this, I formally welcome you all to session one of the Unbundled Series 2020 ECCE. I request Sunaina to take the session forward from here.
Thank you so much, Neeraj. Hi, everyone. I'm Sunaina from Makkal Jagriti, and it is my pleasure and honor to be with all of you here. I just remembered my teammate Anthony had said a couple of years ago, you know, there are no conversations around ECCE. Maybe we should make Amitabh Bachchan do a campaign on ECCE, and then, you know, there'll be a lot of buzz around it. But I'm happy that finally, there are a lot of conversations on ECCE with or without Amitabh Bachchan. We don't have Amitabh Bachchan today. He may not be the best person for this session, but we have two very illustrious personalities, both whom myself and Makkal Jagriti draws a lot of inspiration from. And it's my pleasure to welcome both of them here. I'd first like to welcome Dr. Shekhar Seshadri, a very well-known name, not just in Bangalore, Karnataka, but across the country. Doctor is a senior professor at the NIMHANS Child and Adolescent Psychiatry Department, but he's also been the go-to person for many, many things, be it child protection, be it mental health, be it life skills trainings or experiential learning. And most recently, we were very happy to hear that he's also leading the national initiative and resources for child protection, mental health, and psychosocial care, which is a project of NIMHANS in association with the Women and Child Department. And we really truly honored and privileged to have you with us. Thank you so much, Doctor, for joining us. Along with Dr. Shekhar Seshadri, another very inspiring person we have with us, Chitranjan Kaul, who is the director of Center for Learning Resources. Centre for Learning Resources, or CLR, many of you know, has been one of the pioneering organizations in building capacities, especially leadership capacities in the public education system, be it Anganwadis or the primary schools. And they're especially really amazing in the ECC space and when it comes to parenting. I remember I myself was drawn to ECC when I'd heard Chitranjan speak at one of, you know, one such conference, which used to of course happen in the physical spaces and in physical presence. And, you know, we took away as an organization a lot of learning from that. And I feel really elated to have you with us, Chitranjan. Thank you so much for joining us. At this point, I'd also like to share with everyone, unfortunately, Uma Mahadevan, who was supposed to be with us as a panelist today, is unable to make it due to a personal emergency. She is again another very inspiring person, so passionate about Anganwadis and so passionate about children and early childhood especially. We would have loved to have her for this session, but hopefully sometime in the future, we will bring her for a session. But we feel that both the panelists we have so much to share that we are happy that we get more time to hear their thoughts in this session. So the way we've planned this session is really we had a lot of questions coming in from the participants and from our own team. So we've put together a bunch of themes and topics and questions for both of you. But before we go into that, we thought we could start with an opening remark from you. ECC is, such an important topic of discussion, and it has come more into light these days, but it has always been important. A statement in the recent the new national education policy that really struck a chord with me and made me go, wow, that's true, was it said ECC will be the most powerful equalizer, and this is the first time I'm reading it this way. So I thought I'd like both of you to share your opening remarks to set the context for this session. We could start with any of you.
Yeah, Chitranjan.
You're on mute.
Well, thank you very much for all your very kind words. I think it's a pleasure to be here. And like you, I also feel somewhat deprived that Umaji is not here today. It would have been very nice to have her here, but another time perhaps. As far as ECC is concerned, I think we've seen it as our calling in some sense for a long time now, not simply because it is, and I'm sure that we'll talk a great deal about why it's important and how it shapes the lives of human beings at early days and forms the foundations of what people will grow up into, but also because, as Sunaina, you were saying, it's the great equalizer is a good way to put it. But I prefer to actually think of it as it's the great enhancer. I think in many ways, I often say when I meet with people that what our society will look like in 20, 30 or 40 years time is being decided in the Anganwadis of this country, the 15 lakh Anganwadis that we have today at this time. Not only because we will set the lives of these children on a particular path, but also because for most of these Anganwadis, and I'm sure most of the people who are here with us today work with the deprived sections of the community, of the society, and so on, their access to ECCE, their access to all that developmental and growth opportunities is through the Anganwadis. And when those people begin to get better opportunities, we break some very, very pernicious chains of intergenerational poverty, intergenerational deprivation, intergenerational discrimination. And that then lays the foundations for something beautiful to happen to the society, to the community, 10, 20, 30, 40 years down the line. So as a society, as a community, if there was one thing, I think that we, it would make sense for us to commit ourselves to and give our resources to, I would say that's the early childhood care development education.
Wow. I think that's a very powerful thing you said, CK. If there is one thing we would, or we should divert our resources, ECC, that would be such a, game changer, I could say. Dr. Sheshadri, what would you like to say?
Again, I would like to echo the points that Kaul Sahib made just now, that we miss Uma Mahadevan, particularly because when she was principal secretary in the Department of Women and Child Development, Government of Karnataka, we had the honor and the privilege to execute a very large project in the state of Karnataka, but which expanded to the rest of the country and indeed to the rest of South Asia. And the 0 to 6 age group, the Anganwadis, were a particular source of concern and interest to us. Today, Sunaina, I don't know whether to start with NEP or to start with COVID or to start with child development the structure of the brain. But let me just say that, when I was looking at NEP 2020 in early childhood education and what they call learning in the formative years, and what they say about developing curiosity or arts and craft and music or relationship with nature and color and shapes and working together with other kids with play-based and discovery-based learning and the whole emphasis on emotional development. We are at a very interesting time because NEP 2020 has come smack in the middle of COVID. And what have children lost in the COVID? There's been loss of routine, there is loss of structure, there is loss of predictability, there is loss of learning opportunities and loss of social spaces and loss of peer interaction and loss of play. Yeah. And when I look at it in terms of these losses, I'm reminded of what, Mark Twain said, that in the eternal laws of proportionality, the loss of a doll for a child and the loss of a crown for a king are events of the same weight.
Yes.
And that's what I would like to start with, to table the discussion going ahead of just how important 0 to 6 is and how we're going to negotiate this delicate balance between the peri and the post-COVID era and the opportunities that NEP 2020 has provided to revitalize the thinking on 0 to 6 based on the remarkable work that the ICDA system, which is the world's largest welfare scheme, has done, and the kind of work that Kaul Sahib and his agency have done so evocatively, and the kind of preoccupations and concerns that Makkal Jagriti on one hand and Shiksha Lokam on the other hand have to really take this matter forward. So those are some of my starting thoughts, and I think going ahead, we will build on this in the time that we have today.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Doctor. We really, I think this conversation is getting started and we're really excited to see what plays, and I'm sure we're going to take away a lot from today. Before we go into further conversations, CLR has made this very beautiful video that talks about, the sensitive periods or the early childhood period as we know it. And we thought it's a very comprehensive understanding of what this age is all about and why it's so important. So I'll just play that video and then Dr. Sheshadri, I'd like to come back to you and, invite your comments on it. I'll just play the video.
पैदा होता है तो उसके माँ बाप कुटुंब समुदाय और समाज सबकी बहुत सारी आशाएं उसके साथ जुड़ जाती हैं। स्वस्थ होगा, लंबी आयु जिएगा, एक अच्छा बेटा, भाई, पिता, पति, दोस्त, सहकर्मी, मार्गदर्शक बनेगा, समाज को सुंदर और सुलझा हुआ बनाने में हाथ बटाएगा, होशियार, बुद्धिमान और ज्ञानी माना जाएगा, खुद भी सफल होगा औरों को भी सफल बना सकेगा। हम सबकी अपने बच्चों से इस तरह की आकांक्षाएं होती ही हैं। विज्ञान हमें बताता है कि बच्चा हमारे इन चाहे रास्तों से कितना आगे बढ़ पाएगा, ये बहुत हद तक उसके जीवन के पहले 7-8 साल पर निर्भर है। हमारी परंपराएं तो बच्चे में बचपन में ही अच्छे अच्छे संस्कार डालने पे खूब जोर देती है। अब विज्ञान भी ये कहने लगा है कि जिस बच्चे को 6 मास की उम्र में बहुत सारा दुलार, प्यार भरा स्पर्श और सुरक्षा का आभास नहीं मिलता, वो 25 साल की उम्र में किसी को प्यार देने में कठिनाई महसूस करता है। जिसे 2 साल की उम्र में और बच्चों के साथ मिलने खेलने का अवसर नहीं मिलता, उसे 40 साल की उम्र में औरों के साथ मिलकर काम करने में मुश्किल होती है। जिस बच्चे को 6-7 साल की उम्र में नई नई चीजों के बारे में सोचने, चुनौतियां स्वीकारने और मुश्किल गुत्थियां सुलझाने की आदत न पड़ी हो, उसके लिए बड़ा होकर भी ऐसे काम ठीक से करना एक बड़ी मुश्किल बन जाता है। ऐसा क्यों होता है, इसकी बड़ी रोचक कहानी है। जन्म के समय बच्चे के दिमाग में लगभग 10,000 करोड़ छोटे छोटे कोष्ठ होते हैं। 10,000 करोड़, पूरी आकाश गंगा में लगभग इतने ही तारे हैं। इन्हें न्यूरॉन कहते हैं। जैसे जैसे नवजात बच्चे को नए नए अनुभव होते हैं, ये न्यूरॉन दूसरे न्यूरॉनों के साथ कड़ियां जोड़ने लगते हैं, जैसे एक दूसरे से हाथ मिला रहे हो। विज्ञान हमें बताता है कि बच्चा जो कुछ सीखता है उसकी जानकारी इन्हीं कड़ियों में जमा हो जाती है। जो अनुभव बार बार होते हैं या ज्यादा गहरे होते हैं, उनकी कड़ियां खूब गहरा जाती हैं। और कड़ियां जितनी गहरी होती जाती हैं, बच्चे की उस चीज को समझने करने की क्षमता उतनी ही तेज होती जाती है। बार बार सुखद अनुभव होंगे तो सुखद चीजों को समझने करने की क्षमता बनती जाएगी। प्यार, प्रशंसा, सुरक्षा का अनुभव करेगा तो प्यार, प्रशंसा, सुरक्षा औरों तक पहुंचाने के काबिल बनेगा। बार बार गुत्थियां सुलझाने का अवसर मिला तो दिमाग में बन रही कड़ियां आत्मविश्वास का निर्माण करेंगी। जहां जहां दुखद अनुभव होंगे, वहां वैसी ही दृष्टि से संसार को देखने लगेगा। मार खाएगा और असुरक्षित महसूस करेगा तो दिमाग में बन रही कड़ियां संसार से अलग थलग रहने को प्रेरित करेंगी। अगर बड़ों से ज्यादातर गुस्सा ही देखा है तो गुस्सा करने की क्षमता भी बन सकती है और भाग जाने की प्रवृत्ति भी। और अगर अनुभव हुए ही नहीं तो कुछ सोचने, समझने, करने की शक्ति भी बहुत कमजोर, बहुत क्षीण होगी। ऐसे बच्चों में बड़े होकर आत्मविश्वास की भारी कमी हो तो क्या आश्चर्य हो सकता है। इसे एक और तरह से समझ सकते हैं। कोई भी अनुभव हो तो हमारे भीतर उस अनुभव से जुड़ा कोई नया ज्ञान बनता है, उस विषय के बारे में कोई नई जानकारी बनती है। अगर हमारे दिमाग को न्यूरॉनों से बनाया हुआ एक घड़ा माने तो यूं समझें कि हर अनुभव से ज्ञान रूपी अमृत की एक एक बूंद हमारे खड़े में पड़ती जाती है। जैसे जैसे खड़ा भरता जाता है हमारे ज्ञान का भंडार और विकसित होता है। हमारे पास संसार की गुत्थियों को सुलझाने की, सोचने समझने की, कुछ कर दिखाने की शक्तियों को बढ़ावा मिलता है और ये बात हम सब पे लागू होती है। छोटा बड़ा, अमीर गरीब, आदमी औरत, सबके ज्ञान में नए नए अनुभवों से थोड़ी थोड़ी वृद्धि होती ही रहती है। पर 6-7 साल के बच्चों के साथ एक और अनोखी बात होती है, अनुभवों से उनके घड़े में भी वैसे ही ज्ञान की बूंदें पड़ती हैं। फर्क ये है कि उनका घड़ा बहुत लचीला होता है। ज्ञान की बूंदें पड़ने से घड़ा भरता तो है ही, बड़ा भी होता जाता है। जितनी आयु कम है उतना ही घड़ा लचीला है। 2 साल की आयु में एक बूंद पड़ने से जितना फैलता है 6 साल में उससे काफी कम फैलता है और 10 साल में तो बहुत ही कम। छोटी उम्र में बहुत सारे सुखद अनुभव हुए तो घड़ा खूब फैलता है, बच्चे में बहुत सा ज्ञान बटोरने का सामर्थ्य बनता है। फिर जैसे जैसे बड़ा होता जाएगा नए नए अनुभव ये विशाल घड़ा भरते जाएंगे, ज्ञान खूब बढ़ेगा, क्षमताएं खूब निखरेंगी, खुद सफल होगा, औरों को सफल बना पाएगा। छोटी उम्र में सही अनुभव नहीं मिले तो घड़ा छोटा रह जाए। बड़ी उम्र में नए नए अनुभवों से ज्ञान तो बढ़ेगा पर घड़े में कुल कितना ज्ञान समा सकता है इसका फैसला तो हो चुका। ये बच्चा आगे बढ़कर अपने और अपने कुटुंब, समाज और देश के लिए कितना हितकर बन सकेगा इस सामर्थ्य का फैसला हो चुका। न्यूरॉनों के बीच की ये घड़ा बनाने वाली कड़ियां दिमाग के अलग अलग हिस्सों में अलग अलग उम्र में बनती गहराती है। जैसे भाषा समझने बोलने की कड़ियां यूं तो जन्म से ही शुरू हो जाती हैं, लेकिन 5-6 महीने की उम्र में इनमें खूब तेजी आ जाती है। 3-4 साल की उम्र तक ये यूं ही बड़ी तेजी से बनती रहती हैं और फिर धीरे धीरे कम होती जाती है। ऐसा होने के कारण बच्चे की भाषा सीखने, समझने, बोलने की शक्ति इसी समय में सबसे आसानी से बन सकती है। बाद में नहीं होगा ऐसा नहीं है, पर पहले से काफी ज्यादा परिश्रम की जरूरत पड़ेगी और इसलिए जिन बच्चों को इस उम्र में भाषा के अनुभव मिलेंगे उनका भाषा विकास औरों के मुकाबले में काफी अच्छा होगा। यूं कहें कि भाषा से जुड़े अनुभवों के लिए इस उम्र में बच्चे की ग्रहणशीलता बहुत ज्यादा है, तो थोड़े से परिश्रम से भाषा सीखने की क्षमता का बहुत सा निर्माण हो जाता है। अलग अलग क्षमताओं के विकास के लिए यूं ही अलग अलग उम्र ज्यादा ग्रहणशील होती है। सुनने देखने की क्षमताएं पहले साल भर में बहुत तेजी से बढ़ती है और उसके बाद बहुत धीरे धीरे। इस उम्र में बच्चे को इन क्षमताओं को बढ़ाने के पर्याप्त अनुभव न मिले तो बड़े होकर काफी कमियां रह जाएंगी। यूं ही बच्चे के जीवन में भावनाओं को समझने, व्यवस्थित करने और प्रभावी ढंग से काम में लाने की क्षमता पहले 3 साल में अच्छे अनुभवों से खूब बढ़ सकती है। अच्छी बुरी आदतें सीखने की क्षमता की नींव भी लगभग इसी उम्र में पड़ जाती है। इन क्षमताओं के मुकाबले दूसरे लोगों से रिश्ते बनाने की क्षमता का निर्माण थोड़ी देर से शुरू होता है। 2-2.5 साल की उम्र से 6-7 साल की उम्र तक जिन बच्चों को और बच्चों और बड़ों का प्यार भरा सहवास मिलता है उनकी रिश्ते बनाने की, औरों से मिलकर काम करने की, लोगों को मार्गदर्शन देने की क्षमताओं की नींव खूब मजबूत होती है। बुद्धि के इस्तेमाल से बच्चा संसार के बारे में सोचता है, अलग अलग धारणाएं बनाता है, मुश्किलों को सुलझाने के कुर ढूंढता है। इन क्षमताओं की नींव 3 से 7-8 साल तक बनती है। इस उम्र में इन क्षमताओं के विकास के अनुभव मिले तो खूब ग्रहणशील होगा, खूब बुद्धि का विकास होगा, खूब आगे जाकर नई नई चीजें सीख पाएगा। इन सब क्षमताओं के विकास की इन प्रक्रियाओं को एक साथ देखें तो ये साफ हो जाता है कि अलग अलग क्षमताएं बनने की भले अलग अलग समय सारणी हो पर हर उम्र में कई सारी क्षमताओं का विकास होता रहता है। इसलिए ये जरूरी है कि बच्चों को मिलने वाले अनुभव अनेक तरह के विकासों में हाथ बटाते रहें। बच्चों के पूर्ण विकास के लिए उनके आसपास की दुनिया ही काफी है। इसके लिए बहुत से पैसों, किसी खास भवन, किसी विशेष तरह के खिलौनों की जरूरत नहीं पड़ती। घर, आंगनवाड़ी के आसपास आसानी से मिलने वाले अनुभव उनके लिए खूब सिखाने का काम करते हैं। बच्चे अपने आसपास की चीजों को खिलौनों का रूप देते हैं, आसपास के बच्चों से, आसपास के बड़ों से प्यार से मिलते जुलते खेलते कूदते हैं, अपनी राह में आई अड़चनों को दूर करते हैं, झगड़े निपटाते हैं, तो खूब विकास होता है। छोटी उम्र में बच्चों की ग्रहणशीलता पर आज ये चर्चा की, तो आशा है कि आप उनके विकास की प्रक्रिया को और अच्छी तरह समझकर उसे खूब बढ़ावा देंगे। आपका मार्ग खूब प्रशस्त।
Wow, I think in that 10 minutes, it told us so many things, a very comprehensive video film put together by CLR and I think with CK leading from the front. Thanks so much for sharing that, CK. I think it spoke about so many things about the importance of providing holistic experiences in the early years, about the lasting impact it would have, you know, what you do at 2 years, how it has an impact on you when you're at 40, and how these years are essentially the foundational years for every aspect of development. I'd like to invite Dr. Sheshadri here because you're the neuroscience expert. We've heard, CK had to say about this. But also I understand a lot of our audience may not, be so comfortable with Hindi. Apologize for those who are not, so comfortable with the language, but we thought it's an important video to be shown. Dr. Shekhar Sheshadri, may I invite you to share, what is it that's happening in these early years, especially from the neuroscience perspective, that makes it so critical and so important for anybody? You're on mute, doctor.
Yeah. It would make sense for me actually to take off from this marvelous little video that Kaul Saab has shown and take elements of that to bridge any translation gap and use that to really speak about the whole neuroscience. See, if you remember Kaul Saab in his mellifluous baritone, when he started by talking about when children are born, parents have certain expectations and aspirations, of them. That now there are two issues that he highlighted here. One is the fact that almost 90% of brain development occurs by the time a child is 3 years of age, which means the entire cytoarchitecture of the brain is completed by the age of three, and then it starts to slow down. That so, and in fact, brain development starts even before birth, which is why the whole issue of maternal nutrition and immunization and how therefore the ICDS program is structured around enhancing the cytoarchitecture and brain development, so beautifully explained in Kaul Saab's video, as the neuronal, axonal, and dendritic arborization, how the root of a tree, goes into 2 and then 4 and 8 and 16 and 32 and 64 and 1 and 128 and how the connections of those, and that's where knowledge is really stored. That so then somebody asked the question, you mean 10% of our pathetic adulthood, our pathetic as adulthood, is only 10% of brain development? Yes, it is. But that 10% is also because of the impact of the kind of issues that Kaul Saab spoke about. Now, pay attention to what the video said. it spoke about developmental needs and the impact it has not just on brain development, but also those processes of brain development that contribute to various developmental domains: physical, speech and language, social, emotional, and cognitive. Take a perfectly healthy child. Put the child in a jungle. The child will have good nutrition, but nobody will speak and play to the child. That child will not learn language. Take a perfectly healthy child, vision, hearing, everything okay. Just put a bandage in the child's eyes, take it out after 2 years. The child has no visual representation of the world. Safdar Hazmi, the famous theater activist in Delhi, once said, "The limit of your capacity is the limit of your experience." The Ghada example that Kaul Saab gave. One last thought before we invite Kaul Saab to. Children's developmental needs are at a critical age. Nutrition, security, safety, love, encouragement, opportunity, and so on and so forth. And look at how the video shows the impact on what happens in childhood into adulthood. We call these as adult outcomes of early childhood deprivation or pathways to vulnerability. Let's say a child's love needs are not met with for whatever reason. There is parental discord, mother has depression, there is a theme of alcoholism, there's frequent separation. If a child's love needs are not met with for whatever reason, this child grows up into an adult who wants love, who craves for love, who demands love, who does not recognize love when it is given, who is skeptical and dismissive of love, or who becomes an excessive giver of love. So look at the social and behavioral and life skills outcomes of what happens when children's developmental needs across the five domains are not met from a neurobiological basis and a neurodevelopmental basis, but also from the social and emotional consequences that occur when these needs are not met with. This in sum is what is beautifully depicted in this video. And I started with this to really bring to focus the importance both in terms of structural brain development and its ramifications and implications in the five areas of child development that, if not met with, go on to create later outcomes which manifest as different forms of social skills deficit or learning issues or emotional regulation problems, relationship issues, failure to control aggression and failure to recognize social cues and so on. So this is the framework in which we really need to start our cogitation and rumination on this issue. Over to you, Sunaina.
Yeah. I think you gave us a very, the video as well as, you know, what you spoke really is helping me and I'm sure everyone watching understand what is happening in that age, right? Whether 0 to 3, 0 to 5, 6, probably all the way up to 8. And also you spoke about the ramifications of what happens if we don't get the right experiences. I'd like to ask CK now to comment on, you know, we doctor spoke about these different domains and so many things that have to happen. But how do you make this happen? Because it all sounds quite complex and, you know, there is so much, different areas or domains of development that he's talking about, social, emotional, cognitive, fine motor and gross motor and all of this. So how does one get an environment in which all these are possible? Is it as complex as it sounds?
Yes, I think that's often a question, and especially I think the focus on ECCE that has accompanied the adoption of the policy 6-7 years ago has been very welcome, but has also led to this question among people. You know, there is so Does everyone need a PhD in child development to be able to hug a child, for instance? I mean, is that where this is going? And I think it's very, very, very helpful to think about. I mean, we've thought about it a great deal. We've worried about it a great deal. We worried about the questions of how do... So parents, for instance, they look after children naturally, right? And it's important that they not get tied into knots, constantly wondering whether they're doing the right thing, that they not develop a sense of inferiority, that they don't really know enough, and so on. And I think another very interesting fallout, if you like, of this whole question of which we talk about in the film, and yet we know that we have then had to manage the fallout of that in many places. You know, this 80%, 90% that Dr. Seshadri was also talking about. So the first question that I have encountered many, many times is, this can't be right. I mean, I am constantly learning. Even I have a 40-year-old sitting in front of me, or a 30-year-old sitting in front of me, saying, you can't be serious about this. I mean, I know how much I have learned in the last 8-10 years. I've learned calculus, and I've become a doctor, or I am a IAS officer, and so on. All this happened after I was 6. So how can you say that, you know, 90% all done by the time you're 6 years old? I think we've had to talk about that quite a lot, and I think it's important for all of us who engage with people, parents and others who look after children, to make it clear that it's foundations is one thing, and the building is another. The building will get done. It'll get done later, and it can be large, or it can be small, or it can be it can be a grand cathedral, or it can be a small hut, or whatever. It can be all kinds of things. But what you can build is dependent on the foundations that have been laid right in the beginning. And so, to that extent, we all often say, "You're not a doctor at the age of 6." But whether you will ever be capable of becoming a doctor may have been kind of more or less a little bit decided by the time you are 6. You might not be a lover of languages or arts at 6 in the same way that you are when you are 35 years old. But whether you will go there or not in your adulthood is probably decided to a very significant extent by what inputs you had up to, you know, 7 or 8 years of age, and therefore what foundations have been laid for you at that time. And so on, so on, so on. So all kinds of, I mean, we talk about people becoming doctors and collectors and musicians and artists and so on and so forth, and all of them trace their beginnings to the inputs, to the experiences that children have had at in these early years, and to that extent, foundational. It's really, I mean, I think NEP now talks about foundational stage, and it really is foundational. It is the time when foundations are formed, and that then leads to the complex question that you talked about. Big thing now. So, does it mean basically that we are all fundamentally incapable of doing this at the time? And I think children are naturally wired to learn. The important thing that parents and other caregivers, whether it's the community or Anganwadi workers or whoever else comes in contact with them, can do is to provide an environment in which that learning process is not impeded, is not artificially stopped, Right? And to us, it seemed that really it can, the parents' role, the what they can do, what they can provide. And when I say parents, I always mean the larger caregiver community, because that really, it, as someone said, it takes a village to raise a child, and that's really true. That larger community, what can it provide? And we came up with this simple sounding, and we hope it is simple sounding and easy to understand, because it's been our hope and our mission in some sense to say, let's demystify ECCE. Let us make it so that it is accessible to most people rather than turn it into a PhD thesis. So we said, there are really just three things that if you do, it'll be all right. Things will become all right. You don't have to worry about what the child is learning, because she'll learn. Touch, talk, play. Just do that. Provide an environment in which the child receives a whole lot of loving touch. You know, a hug, a holding of hand, a walking together, and so on and so forth. Just touch. Talk. We know about the 30 million word gap between the affluent and less privileged communities. And that gap really just keeps on growing eventually. And so conversations can be a great builder, not only of relationships between the adults and the children, and between children themselves, and so on and so forth. They're also the basis for development of language, which itself is the basis for development of a cultural construct for the child, an understanding of the nature of their connections. They can be the basis for a great deal of cognitive development, brain development of various kinds for the child. So talk is just extraordinary. And Indians are blessed in many ways that they are so dramatically multilingual across a whole range of communities, not everywhere, but quite a lot. And that's an extraordinary piece of an impetus for extraordinary level of cognitive development for the child. So talk, just talk about, and when we say talk, we do mean expressive talk. Often talk in many places is do this, don't do that, get up, stop, go away, etc., etc. That is supposed to be all the talk that a child needs. That's really not true. For a child, the idea that she can talk about what she's feeling, and she can listen to others communicate to her what they are, they believe, think, feel, etc., etc., is an extraordinary opportunity. So talk is the second piece. And play. You don't have to do anything. Children will make a castle out of blocks. They'll make an aeroplane out of a piece of wood. They'll do all sorts of things. They'll pretend they're doctors and engineers and bridge builders and so on and so forth. And each time they do that, they make sense of the world around themselves. They make they invest it with meaning. And that meaning then becomes the basis on which they build their bridges to the rest of the world. Extraordinary contribution to the not only the brain development, which is what we've been talking about, but you know, the reason I'm saying this, of course, brain development is everything, but often when people think about brain development, they think this means the ability to do maths or the ability to pass examinations. I don't mean only that, though there is that. Play creates that. But I mean the ability to form relationships, the ability to empathize, the ability to connect with other people, the ability to work together with other people, and so on. All of this. Play is extraordinarily powerful. And you don't have to actually, you just have to leave the child to be able to play. They will play. If you can find a little time, and spend 10 minutes or 15 minutes or 20 minutes or 30 minutes with the child playing, that's wonderful. But not because without you, she would not be able to play. But because it makes a relationship sense for her that you're playing with her. But creating an environment for children where touch, talk, play comes naturally on an ongoing basis, without any impediments, without any difficulties. I really believe that is all you need for the first 6 years. They are not doing calculus. They are not doing aerospace engineering at this time. And so, if we can do that, I think we'll be fine. We'll be fine if we can provide that atmosphere.
I think you've truly demystified, early learning for us, that you really don't need fancy materials, spaces, or anything. It's just about touch, talk, and play, very simply and very nicely put. Dr. Seshadri, would you like to add something to, how do we provide these experiences? Anything else you'd like to add to that?
There are some very interesting points that Kolsa has raised. The issue of, between process and content, the kind of knowledge we gain at the age of 20, 30, and 40 is a lot of content, that is added to. But as the late Frank Zappa, rock musician, says, information is not knowledge. Knowledge is not wisdom. Wisdom is not truth. Truth is not love. Of course, he goes on to say love is music. But in the context of what Kolsa mentioned, let us not tie ourselves into knot with numbers and percentages like 90 and 10. The truth is very simple. As someone, these are not my words, but someone said, fish swim, birds fly, children play.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely. It's as simple as that. And as Kolsa pointed out, even a discarded toffee wrapper is a plaything for a child, because it has texture, it has sound, and it takes flight if you drop it in the wind. And so how children use materials. And so if you look at all the systems of education, right from the whole play with materials, from the Montessori system, or if you look at the more anthroposophic practices that from Rudolf Steiner and nature, music, art, movement, and how that makes a difference in the way that children's coordination, their hand functions, the connectedness, and how therefore relationship building and socialization processes through play. And that's really the difference between a processed play and an unprocessed play. We have a lot of situations where, young couple gone off to Dubai, the father's away most of the day, the young mother is told, don't go out, it may not be safe. Forget about leaving the country. This is the first time she's out of her village. And here is a kid who is 6 months old, and she's silent, she's petrified, some connection with the family, the kid is in front of the TV, it's not processed, and they come back a year later, and someone makes a diagnosis of autism, because the child has not had language stimulation and social stimulation, no peer group, no play. So that's the kind of impact that lack of stimulation has on. And so how stimulation is important and how processing of stimulation is important, and how both stimulation and processing needs to occur in a social context, because learning is social. The presence of the facilitator, the parent, the teachers. And so it's a very simple issue of predominantly using the medium of play, and of material and of creativity to basically have those neurons fire. And then when you give it a social construct and a structure, all these pretend games, ki chal papa ko phone karte, usse poocho papa, khana kha liya? So you're creating the whole script and the dialogic sense of what relationship means, or kab ghar aoge, आइसक्रीम जरूर लेके आना. एंड सो हाउ नीड्स एंड रिलेशनशिप्स एंड इमोशंस एंड सेंसेशंस एंड टेस्ट्स एंड स्मेल्स एंड साउंड्स आर यू नो ब्रॉट अलाइव दैट. And you know, I'm suddenly reminded of what Nietzsche said many years ago, you know, about art. And, you know, he said art exists so that you do not die of reality.
Yes.
so that's really the power of art and play, and how it is important in the early years that to, you know, keep that going. That there's only one issue that I wanted to mention, not as a counterpoint to what we have discussed so far, but just as something to think about for those of us who work in the area of early childhood care and education, which is the role of early or adverse childhood experiences and childhood trauma, and what that does to child development. And you know, COVID is a current pandemic. Domestic violence and adverse childhood experiences are an everlasting pandemic. That and the tragedy that we listen to in a clinical setup sometimes, of you know, the kind of realities and often brutality. Or brutal circumstances that family come with, and what happens to those children. Now, adverse childhood experiences and childhood trauma have significant impact on those parts of the brain that really control emotional regulation, because children do not have, therefore, you know, experiences in which the regulator develops. Particularly those experiences that cause attachment injuries, you know, frequent separations, a mother with depression, unable to engage with the child, and the sensitivity to understand given the, and this child is bright, this child is capable of learning, but you know, there are, so what happens in the space where early childhood education taking place is one thing, but the child goes back to a space and, you know, do they counteract each other and cancel the impact that it has, and how do we maintain something that goes on in the home situation itself? The other issue that I want to bring to notice is children with mild disability, not moderate, severe, profound, because those kids may never reach a school space, but kids who are very mild in the kind of problems that they have, you know, mild left-right disorientation, mild clumsiness, and you know, many of these kids, you know, as Kalsa was finding out, many of them actually are so intelligent that they go on to become, they complete their MBBS and become doctors and write prescriptions that nobody can read, except for the pharmacist. That now they don't write badly deliberately; they cannot write. It's a writing disability, because because there was this issue in. So how sensitive are our service providers in early ECCE spaces to recognize children with mild disability, and also to recognize children who come from vulnerable backgrounds, and therefore provide an emotionally corrective, playful, joyous atmosphere, you know, so that it counteracts the kind of reality that the children come from? So this is, and NEP 2020 emphasizes quite significantly, and I think I see questions already coming in on chat, and I'd just like to take the one point that Ms. Shikha Agarwal has made in terms of interventions for children who parents are going through separation, you know, at a critical age, very young age, 1, 2, and 4, so that their development growth does not get negatively impacted. And it is precisely maintaining developmental experiences and stimulation for this child, even though you are going through a problem that, but if a lot of time and preoccupation is around resolving parental conflict, and the amount of time the child has is compromised or is negatively affected, that, so how do you keep alive play? How do you keep alive stimulation and exploration by this child of all sensations and parameters in the environment, so that despite the separation process that the parents are going, the child's development is not affected. That, and even if it means, you know, 1 hour of play or 2 hours of play, you know, in instead of it falling completely flat because there's so much of stuff going on. That,
I think what you're sharing also, you know, answers a question somebody else has asked about how does a child cope with two very different environments where, you know, the school environment is offering probably a positive reinforcement, whereas at home the child is, you know, experiencing something negative. It could be abuse, it could be neglect. So you're saying at least let us give what the school or the, you know, learning space can offer. Is there...
Yes, Sunana, I mean, this may not be that relevant. I mean, it is relevant in ECCE because, you know, it's people may argue that does a two-year-old have a memory? Does a four-year-old have a memory? And it's an interesting exercise. If I were to ask each of you, you know, call Saab, Sunana, Neeraj, what is the earliest memory you have? How far back, you know, and is it confirmed? Have you confirmed that it truly happened? You'd be surprised. I mean, I remember stuff that happened at 2, 2.5. I'm 64 this year. And I've confirmed it happened, you know. And this is not because I have a remarkable memory or anything like that. You know, it's just that it's something that happened very often, or it happened once, but it was unforgettable. You know, which is why, you know, how do you create memories for children? That, and why do children therefore say, you know what I remember about, or adults when you ask, you know what I remember about my childhood? I remember that in my house, I had an antique bell. It was 100 years old. It was my job to ring it during meal times. And now at age of 35, it has pride of place in my house. You know what I remember about my childhood? You know that mango orchard in the backyard and was stealing mangoes even when I was 6 years old and I got caught and I got a thrashing from the guy who... Or you know what I remember about my childhood? All I remember is every day, you know, thinking to myself, why the hell was I born in this family? So experiences in the Anganwadi can really make a difference. And this is why when this 35-year-old techie comes back to school and meets his teacher who's on the verge of retirement and says, teacher, do you remember me? And she looks at him, you know, and then puts on her glasses and says, no, sorry, I don't. He says, but I've never forgotten you. I don't know whether you remember. I come from a very bad family circumstance. And truth be told, I'm not reconciled with my family. But I don't know what it is that you saw one day on my face. I was 6 years old. You know, I'm 35. I'm talking about 30 years ago. You called me aside and I still remember you didn't shame me in front of other children. And you asked me, child, you'll appear to be weighed down. Is anything the matter? And I told you, mummy, papa, ghar mein jhagda karte hain, jhagda karte hain. And you said, you know, it must be so difficult to, you know, please feel free to speak to me. And teacher, I have never, ever forgotten that act of kindness. So you'd be amazed the kind of impact that, you know, you can make on children's lives, that you can change the trajectories of their life by even a small intervention of this nature. You know, the graphs that Kaul Sahib showed, if, you know, a trajectory is going some way, you give a little intervention and you can completely change the trajectory of children's lives. That's the remarkable power of early childhood care and education. Over to you, Sunaina.
You know, there's a question I just read, and it's also a question often asked. You know, we did not go through formal preschools. A lot of us, probably both of you also, you know, never went to an Anganwadi or a preschool, probably directly started with school. I'm not so sure, but I'm making an assumption here. So the question is, why now so much talk and, you know, pressure on, in a way, formal learning or learning itself for this 3 to 6 years age group. CK, would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I think the first thing really, we should go back to that whole story that really what children need is touch, talk, play. For this period. And why has this whole question of early childhood care, development, education, etc., assumed such significant importance, not just in India, but elsewhere? I think there's an interesting statistic that might be helpful. I think if I remember right, in the 1982 census of India, 1981 or 82, 48% of India's population lived in what were then classified as nuclear families. The number was 48%. In the 2012 census, the latest, that number jumped to about 72%. So in the space of one generation, 30 years, we saw a 50% increase in the number of unitary families, the number of families which live just the parents, young parents, and the child. That has had some very interesting, perhaps undesirable, effects. One, it has led to the loss of the matrix of care that was available to a child from not just one, but several caregivers. We've been creating a series of small talks about parents' education. And so on. One of them is called Bada Kutum Sukhi Kutum. And we talk about in that about how the presence of a number of different caregivers simply acts as different types of inputs for the child. It simply provides for a more holistic set of inputs for the child, which then makes it possible for them to experience a wider range, not only of wider range of care, wider range of affection, wider range of cognitive development, and so on and so forth, all that. That has been lost to our children, to a very large number of our children. That's one thing that has happened as a result of this increasing nuclearization. The second thing that has happened is that the support systems that were available to the parents in those larger spaces have been lost. So A, the support systems are gone. B, a whole lot of wisdom, parenting wisdom that existed as a part of that whole matrix. That's gone. So you have really young parents who have very little understanding, who have had very little grounding in what it means to be a parent. And like I said, I think if all they knew was touch, talk, play is enough, that would be enough. But it is not. They don't get that. They get all kinds of really unfortunate inputs about what it means to be a good parent, et cetera, et cetera. So what is happening really is that a whole lot of our young parents are really ill-equipped to provide the care at this time that children need. And so what has happened as a result of that is that the need for some kind of institutionalized care has become necessary. I think it's unfortunate in many ways. I think that is where we are as a society. But it's a reality. It is true that parents are at a loss, not just in urban areas, but also in rural areas. And so to that extent, I feel it becomes necessary to do something institutionally. Unfortunately, I don't think we have done too well, even institutionally. I think it took us 40 years of ICDS to even acknowledge ECC as a priority by talking about a policy. And if you look at the last 7 years of the policy having been in existence, I think we've taken it casually. We have not really, I think it's hard to say that we have used these 7 years well as we could have, let's say. There are many states where there's a lot of work that has been done, a lot of improvement has happened. And yet overall as a country, I think we have not really taken that thing as seriously as possible. And I think one thing that the policy does, and which has not received any attention at all, is the policy talks about parent education. I'm talking about 2013 policy now. It talks about parent education. It talks about engagement with parents. The entire focus of ICDS has almost everywhere, and there are honorable exceptions, but otherwise it has been on what to do in Anganwadis. Whether that has happened well or not, that's a separate question, but the focus has been on that. But really, I think the question of ICDS needs really very, very strongly to focus on how parents can participate, can be coached, can learn how to provide the right kind of atmosphere to children. And COVID has really sort of brought us face to face with that suddenly much more. Today, all the rage is about, okay, how do we get that care which Anganwadis would have provided in homes, and therefore parents have become the front line in some sense as far as the governments are concerned. And it should always have been like that, and it should be like that going forward as well, that parents must be seen as an integral part of the overall system which provides the inputs to the children, apart from. And having said that, as I said, the reasons that we talked about, I think institutionalized care will be a necessity in some ways.
I think you touched upon a very important priority of ICDS, right? While probably when it came to health or nutrition or immunization, all of them much better for it being such a large scheme. But if you look at the Anganwadi worker, she hardly receives training in ECC. She does not, there is no monitoring of ECC as such. Nobody is asking her, aaj kya kiya bachon ke saath? You're only asking, what did you... So, you know, how much you gave or how much Zal you gave. So what would it take with DS and with Anganwadi? So what would it take to really make ECC a priority for the ICDS, for the educational aspect?
I'm sure Kalsab would have a lot to say because of the very nature of the organization that he works in. I mean, I'm in a mainstream health facility, but I just want to make one point on this, Sunaina, and I would request Kalsab to elaborate on this, and also see whether it can be linked with a lot of questions that have come, you know, from Mohan Singh Rawat and from Makkal Jagriti itself about the whole economic divide, you know, which 0 to 6 group of children are we speaking about, and ICDS and Anganwadi is really catering to a certain socioeconomic segment, and so are there going to be compromises and obstacles to the actual delivery of care there? Now, one of the things that we found, and I hope that with NEP 2020 and the way in which it could perhaps revitalize at least the ICDS scheme. And this is why I wish Uma ma'am had been here, because of a lot of work that she'd done when she was the principal secretary at DWCD in the government of Karnataka, is that while there are job development centers and there are agencies that train the Anganwadi workers, and sometimes with the form filling and this excessive preoccupation with immunization and nutrition, looking at the other domains of development and the extent to which, and a lot of these Anganwadis, there are these spanking new toys not even taken out of their plastic covers. Toot jayega ye, are tootne do yaar. You know, let them break that. So, you know, how much is material used, and what happens is, see, one of the things is hand functions are so central to many of the things that we do, that, you know, and hands have, you know, you can sense texture and temperature and you can lift and you can press and you can push and you can pull and squeeze and twist and throw and you know, the hands have. And if in an Anganwadi or in an ICD's hand functions are not focused on, a child comes at age 6 to preschool, doesn't have readiness skills. And that's where learning problems start. And then, you know, there is this whole emphasis on performance and then rejection and criticism and self-esteem goes down and the parents smack the kid by saying, you're not doing well. And you see how a whole drama plays itself out merely because readiness skills were not focused on that. So this is one thing we need to keep in mind. And, you know, and again, coming back to the very point that Kaul Sahib made, it's very simple. Let's not get into complex. It's very simple hand function. Just use that. Do stuff with the hand. You know, do all kinds of stuff. That's all is required. And then, you know, how you develop the readiness skills. And this is just for writing. Similarly for other skills. Then. Over to you, Kaul Sahib. Kaul Sahib also requests that many people are raising this issue of the economic divide, people coming from underprivileged circumstances, they online learning, they don't have smartphones, they find it difficult for three meals, and how do we really negotiate this, that, you know, from your vast experience?
So quickly, I think let me take Dr. Shadri's second question first. This whole question of digital divide, et cetera. Children don't need computers or phones or tablets or anything to do what they need to do to get to where they need to get to. Which means that, as we said earlier, and Dr. Shadri was talking about it quite eloquently a short while ago, play. Talk to the child, touch them, give them a sense of security and safety. Give them a hug. And they will do all the things that they need to do in order to get to the point where, so they will naturally pick up something and scribble on the ground. You don't have to tell them, now we will do an activity for developing hand-eye coordination. They will develop hand-eye coordination if they're not locked up in one place, in one room, where there's nothing else to play with, and so on. So children do not need the fancy stuff. To that extent, for children, the question of the digital divide, which will happen as they go forward, as they go into school, where unfortunately there'll be more of this stuff. But at the youngest ages, that is not an issue. But it does come up in a very interesting way. So, for instance, as I said, in COVID times, we work in a lot of Anganwadis where we try to, develop the capacities and the space where the Anganwadi workers can provide the right kind of stimulation, environment, et cetera, for the children and so on. Now, COVID has stopped all of that for the moment. And what we did was we responded by creating a whole series of messages for parents. Talking about the kind of things we've just been talking about here. I mean, it's not rocket science again. focusing especially on the messages what are the things that parents, whether they are literate or not literate, whether they are well off or not well off, what can they do which provides a rich learning environment for their children? So this is what we've been doing. And of course, ICDS is the natural transmission medium for these things. ICDS has an Anganwadi in every village of this country. It's an extraordinary reach. There are 15 lakh Anganwadis in this country in 15 lakh villages approximately. So we've, and of course, because we've been working with ICDS quite a lot for a long time, we've been basically, we've teamed up with ICDS in several states to get these messages out to the parents. Some very nice things have happened. As of now today, we estimate that probably something like 5-6 lakh families are getting these messages on a weekly basis. The reach of these families, these Anganwadis through which these messages go, is probably 50 lakh families. We're only able to reach about 5 lakh. Why is that? Number of reasons. Some parts of that are simply that, you know, as there's probably 40% of India's children who the Anganwadi system doesn't even pick up, unfortunately. They are somewhere and so on. And then you have the next step that causes the decline in the reach is digital divide. Our messages can go down if the Anganwadi workers have a phone, because that's how they receive them, and then that's how they play them to the parents. In one state that we work in, about 65-70% Anganwadi workers have phones. An even smaller number has meaningful access to internet, and therefore the ability to receive it. An even smaller number has independent access to a phone, because actually the phone is the family's phone. So the message can come, but you know, it's with the husband, or it is with the father, or it's with somebody else, and it gets lost, and so on and so forth. So we experienced digital divide in that way, for instance. We experienced that we could have reached twice as many people, perhaps, if that hadn't been there. If the adults in the system, which is the Anganwadi workers, supervisors, etc., had the ability to access these messages and to take them to the parents and so on. As it is, yeah, that reach is probably cut by 50% or something like that. We try different ways in which to address that, and hopefully we'll get, you know, there are ways. People have been very enterprising. They have found different interesting ways of doing that. And yet there are people who don't get it. And so the reason I'm telling this whole story is I think it's important for us to look at, in the context of ECCE, what this digital divide actually means. It does not mean the ability of a child to open a tablet and listen to a nursery rhyme being played to her on the, it doesn't matter. It's not necessary. She doesn't, there's not a huge amount of deprivation that a child experiences because of that. The child can get everything that she needs without those things. But I think it is true that digital divides are creating a distinction between those who might receive the information, those parents who might receive the information, and those who might not. I think that's a reality, and I think all of us have to be working on that on an ongoing basis to the extent that we can. So that's where I would come down on that one. But I really feel, I think it's very important for all parents of under 6, under 7, under 8 children to recognize that you don't need computers for them. Children don't need computers. You might need computers. That's possible. That I'm willing to acknowledge that. As parents, you might need it. But children don't need them. In fact, there's tons of evidence today that it is not good for children to spend a lot of time in front of screens. You might not be able to prevent a child from looking at a screen simply because there's so many of them around that you can't very well keep them away if you are sitting in front of the screen all the time. But let us not labor under the misconception that if the children do not have a screen in front of them, there is some big deprivation going on. There isn't. And I'm talking about children under 7 or 8 at the start.
So actually, what I asked you earlier, that's kind of linked with what Neeraj wants to ask you. We're kind of running out of time. I did not expect when I look at the time that it would be 6:25 already.
I have a suggestion, Sunaina. One of the things that you could do is when you start the next session talking about experiences from the field and the third one on ideating, the next session could start with a summary of the 15 odd points and comments that have been made on chat, and I can summarize them for you very quickly. A lot of them have to do with the digital divide, screen time, affordability, and whether there is a design to implement a model in deprived communities. And so the whole privilege versus deprivation paradigm seems to be coming through very strongly in, and this is one issue that you could. The second issue that has come up is a more technical issue or rather programmatic issue, which speaks of concepts like metacognition and other than the three, you know, the touch talk and play paradigm, are there any other simple things that, so some focus on methods that you could speak about. The third theme that seems to be coming through is the whole theme of trauma, and which is why I have put the website, which we developed as part of our work when Uma Mahadevan ma'am was the principal secretary, which is www.nimhanschildproject.in. And if you navigate this website and look at the sections on interventions and training, there's a lot of stuff on how to work with trauma, both with very young children as well as with some questions that have come on the older age group. So I wanted to say that these are three major themes that seem to be coming from the chats, and you could sort of summarize this as a preamble or as an opening to the next session. So I wanted to table that and take the opportunity to thank Shiksha Lokam and Makkal Jagriti very much for this opportunity, and also the privilege and honor of sharing a platform with Chitranjan Kaul. And over to Mr. Kaul for some of his comments in closing.
Neeraj actually has a question for which we require your closing remarks, but thanks so much for summarizing all the question and answer. We were actually thinking we would respond to them post this, you know, because some may be very specific to what both of you could bring. So if that be the case, we'll write to you and ask for your comments as well. Sure. What do you need?
Thank you so much, Sunaina. I think Dr. Shishalti said definitely, I think you made our job a little easier by elaborating on how to answer these very specific questions. So thank you so much for that. I think just one question that's in our minds, and I think everyone really is looking forward to, you know, hearing both of you is, given the conversation that we've had about ECCE and the National Education Policy, what do you see the future? And how do you see this really going forward? I think that's, I mean, that's something that we all want to take forward in the next, you know, the conversations as well. I think as closing thoughts and closing remarks, we would love to hear what are you envisioning the ECCE and National Education Policy really going forward?
Call, sir.
would you like to
mera to mamla bahut hi saral hai. I want to come back to what Sunaina said. We have started this national initiative and integrated resource for child protection, mental health and psychosocial care. We had completed last year a small project but a very deep one on Anganwadis and child protection, and to look at how child protection issues actually impact on education and development of children. So our focus, Neeraj, will be to, and I, when I looked at NEP 2020, I'm amazed at the extent of focus it has on mental health and emotional well-being. That, and as someone, as WHO said, there is no health without mental health. That, so our focus through this project is going to be to work extensively in the education sector and with ICDS as well to look at the relationship between child protection, mental health and education, and see what kind of activities that And just for your information, the website that I gave you in the intervention section has a lot of material that we developed for Anganwadis, including for Karnataka, a set of almost 30 to 40 songs that Anganwadi teachers themselves collected and put together. That so we have a lot of material on how to work at other areas of development, which then contribute to core pre-education or early education. So this is a commitment that we have, and we would be happy to work. We are supported to work with Makkal Jagriti, with Shiksha Lokam, with CLR, and our assistance and collaboration with you is absolutely mandated and supported. There will be no training fee. There will be no resource fee. We are supported to do this. It will be our honor and privilege to associate with all of you.
Wow, thank you.
Thank you very much. That's wonderful. Thank you very much. It really makes a difference to the kind of work that we can do. And thank you very much for making that offer. I think to respond to Neeraj's question, I think I see two key issues going forward on NEP. I think it's a document with a great deal of heart. It has some very, it says all the right things. It has very good sentiments. If you go into it, you see everything you'd like to see there. I think there are, unfortunately, I think we have seen in India very good policies and very, very, very poor implementation, which then leads essentially to not very much happening on the ground. And I think NEP is a sufficiently complex document in terms of what it sets out to do, in terms of how much it sets out to do and how much it hopes to do, that attention to implementation is absolutely critical. Without that, not very much will happen, especially in the area of early childhood, where we now have a really complex process, which is that four ministries must work together. I mean, usually one ministry finds it difficult to work with itself. So to have four ministries work together across different states, especially also because these are going to be state level, et cetera, it's a very complex process. And I think that we must worry, and I think the government must worry as well with us, that the complexity of implementation is not sufficiently provided for. And I think the biggest challenge in that sense, I see in the implementation of the policy and of reaching meaningful outcomes over a reasonably short period of time, not three generations, is the leadership quality in the implementing structures, the ministries, the departments, and so on and so forth. We've over the last 8 or 10 years, we've really dedicated ourselves to trying to help to work with governments to develop leadership qualities, leadership skills among people who provide leadership to these departments. I think that will remain, in my opinion, the most critical input, which has not been talked about at all, unfortunately, in the NEP. It seems to have been taken for granted that it is there. The fact is that it is not. And to that extent, I think that's one important area of concern going forward. The second, as we talked about earlier, is the whole question of parent coaching and education. The reality is that the parents are not well equipped, and the reality is that that reaching resources to them, which would make them better equipped to work with their children, to provide the right kind of atmosphere to the children. That has not happened. It is not very difficult. It's not very difficult to do that. We've done several pilot programs in different states, different places, which have demonstrated how much parents can impact, learn and change and so on. And even now within this COVID time, we've started this, as I was talking about earlier, the Sajag program, which is essentially a series of audio messages that go out to parents. And in spite of its broadcast nature, we've seen significant learnings happening at the parent level and in the chain of transmission in the ICDS, which is a great thing because once those capacities build in ICDS, they can continue to use them over a period of time over and over again. So we think there are certain specific action steps that can be taken, as I said, A, to build leadership capacities in ICDS and other departments who are going to do this as a part of the NEP, and to provide parent support and parent coaching and essentially community level empowerment to look after our children, to help them grow more meaningfully. I think that is what I think are the two pieces that I would strongly recommend to the government to look at as they look to implement NEP.
Thank you so much, sir. I think exactly these are the questions that I think we will have to constantly start looking into. And I mean, that's exactly, I think, why the session and the series even came to existence. And both of you, I think, just gave the context in such powerful perspective that I hope, I mean, to me, this was a crash course on ECC. And I feel like that definitely is, I think that for me is a wonderful takeaway as such. So I think first and foremost, I really have to thank both of you, Chitranjan sir and Dr. Shekhar Seshadri, for not just being a part of this conversation, but just for making it so enriching and making it, this powerful. And I think from both Shiksha Lokam and Makkal Jagriti, we can't thank you both enough. And the fact that even Dr. Seshadri agreed to kind of collaborate and take conversations forward, I think is such empowerment to all organizations in the field. So I think on behalf of all the attendees and both of the organizations that are hosting, thank you so much, both of you, for being a part of this conversation. Second, I have to thank Sunaina for being such a great facilitator for the entire conversation. I think we tried covering as much as possible, and I think Sunaina, thank you so much for that. And I think in the end, to conclude this, I'd really like to thank the amazing set of participants who've not just been, engaging here, but just asking such relevant questions that have made this conversation, that much more enriching. I'm just going to take what Chitranjan sir said in the end. Our next conversation is exactly about the said, things that sir said about what are we doing with implementation of the recommendations of the national education policy itself. So a brief information about the next session. So we're meeting again on September 17th, that's next Thursday, at 5 p.m. And the conversation is going to be one, understanding best practices from organizations, such as CLR and Pratham, and also listen to, academicians such as Professor Vinita Kaul, who's been who's been a part of the entire, drafting of NEP of sorts in terms of recommendations. We will also start deep diving into the implications of national education policy and really see how we as a collective can start bringing solutions onto the table. And with that, I think I'll thank one and all for being a part of this conversation. Hope to see you all for the next session. We'll share the details of it very soon. So yeah, thank you so much, everyone, for joining. From Shiksha Lokam and Makkal Jagriti, we are super grateful. Thank you.
Namaste.
Thank you. Namaste. Very much. Thank you. It's been a pleasure. Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Thank you, Dr. Seshadri.
Kaul sahab, pleasure to meet you. Milenge phir.
Zero.